Audible? Awesome. Hi everyone, my name is Avik Mishra. I work at Intuit, and it's very exciting to be here at RootConf. We have had such great talks, and I'm really thankful to the RootConf organizers for having me here. I'll be talking about something which is very close to my heart, and that is, the title of my talk is Evolution of Monitoring. I've been working in the monitoring domain for the past 7 or 8 years, and it's been really exciting and interesting to see some of the developments happening in the monitoring tool landscape and how they have been necessitated and motivated by the changes in application landscape. Mainly how the applications are now getting, you know, architected, the way they are getting hosted, the way they are getting deployed. Since this is a 20-minute talk, I'll just give you a broad high-level overview of what are those different changes which kind of trigger the rethink of whether your monitoring is delivering the kind of insights and information that you want. So without further ado, let me jump right in. This is how it started for me around, you know, 7-8 years back, and we were using Nagios and RRD tool. And mind you, these tools are great. They work fantastically well for hundreds of organizations even today. The thing is, at that point of time, we actually wanted, you know, to scale out big time, because we had millions of metrics coming in per minute, and something like a RRD tool or an Agios were not able to cope up. Again, I say this with a disclaimer, because I know both these tools are undergoing evolution even today, and now you have the concepts of clustering. RRD tool has something like the RRD cache T, and so on and so forth. But some of the things that I'll talk about actually are tool agnostic in a way that they will have a very high bearing on what your monitoring looks like. So let's look at some of that. And coming back to the origin point, does it need to change? Maybe, maybe not. Perhaps your monitoring is already geared towards some of those changes, and all you need to do is, you know, make some improvements to it. So let's look at, you know, some of the developments taking place in the industry. Microservices, I think we have heard a lot about it. Microservices are just loosely coupled services, and, you know, independently deployable. And one of the bearings that microservices has had is, now you have hundreds of services out there. And indeed, we heard in one of the morning talks that, you know, it could be one of the 99 services which could be actually errant or problematic. But how do you actually know about it in the entire scheme of things? Microservices also mean that the application architectures are changing very frequently. You know, gone are the days when you had architecture diagrams which were relatively kind of static, change once in every, you know, 1 or 2 years. Nowadays, with hundreds of services and many more services coming into the mix, you know, the application architectures are changing very frequently. But the underlying concept of why an architecture diagram is required is still very relevant. And that is to understand the connections and the dependencies between the different services and the interrelationships. So we still need a visualization of your application topology. Now, this is a, you know, one of the tools that we use in Intuit in our consumer tax group called AppDynamics, but it need not necessarily be this tool. It could be any one of the other tools also. There is, you know, the open source Zipkin from Twitter. The idea is, how do you get a visualization of your service map, and how are you able to kind of trace the relationships and the problems that are taking place? And for that, it's very necessary to have the monitoring tool itself give that kind of information to you, in terms of what are the application relationships, what are the upstream and downstream dependencies. As you can see, you know, this kind of a view is very important for a DevOps engineer to understand what are the source of bottlenecks in a service-based environment. But is this a silver bullet? Certainly not. As you can see, so when you try to map out the entire application ecosystem, it can easily get out of hand, whatever the tracing technology is. And you see here a maze of services talking to each other, and it is, you know, incomprehensible. So this area, or this, you know, this field is still undergoing innovation. There's a lot to be thought about it. And, you know, there's a tool by Adrian Cockcroft, who is the, you know, many of you know, is the former cloud architect in Netflix. He has been trying to do something on this field. The idea is, how do you get a visualization of your application topology in a way that makes sense and that helps you not only understand the architecture, but where the bottlenecks are? Visibility in business transactions. Again, something very, very important. We all know the power of instrumentation libraries. Like, I think many of us have used AdsD, CollectD. In my time, in my previous organization, I was part of a team that built an instrumentation library from scratch. Now, many of these instrumentation libraries will spew out, you know, very relevant metrics about critical pieces of your code. But at the end of the day, the degradation of a metric does not necessarily imply the degradation of a user experience, or you need to know the exact degradation that is happening in terms of the business transaction the user is executing. Now, what do I mean by a business transaction? In an e-commerce application, it could be viewing all items, or it could be, you know, adding to cart, or it could be paying, or it could be login. So we need to understand how those business transactions are getting impacted. And for doing so, what you need is an end-to-end view. Just, you know, having the instrumentation from a particular critical piece of code may or may not be able to tell you whether the entire business transaction is doing healthy or unhealthy. Monitoring in cloud. I think we have seen this concept beaten to death today. Many people have talked about it, but I think it's very important to understand that monitoring in cloud is very different from, you know, monitoring in data centers. The reason being, many of the monitoring tools assume a static infrastructure. So we have heard about techniques in which you can tie in things like survey discovery with some of these tools and make them dynamic in nature, but the underlying concept still remains the same. With, like, for example, EC2 instances getting torn down in AWS, you still need to understand, you know, how your backend hosting infrastructure is changing so that you are able to still monitor. So that's why you have this concept of monitoring the cattle versus the pets. Evolution of time series databases. This is again something very close to my heart. I've actually followed the evolution of time series databases from RRD tool, and RRD tool works great, but again it has scaling problems. So we went to something like a MySQL, and believe it or not, MySQL works great because of the fact that, you know, an RDBMS database is very suited for a metric and dimension kind of a schema, that star schema kind of thing. But again, MySQL sharding also becomes a pain after some point of time. So then we actually have monitoring tools or frameworks actually adopt databases that are inherently scalable in nature, which means we are looking at something like an InfluxDB, an OpenTVsDB, which is based on HBase, or even having in-memory databases for the very recent time periods. Moving towards unified monitoring. Again, a very important concept. Unified monitoring here does not mean that you are using a single tool. What I mean here is you are covering all the aspects of monitoring. And often, more often than not, we forget that we have to monitor from the perspective of the end user, what is called the real user monitoring. We need to have mobile monitoring in place, because in a mobile first world, all the mobile, like, we are actually seeing applications that are having more traffic in mobile. So how do you do crash reporting? How do you do analytics? Custom insights, very important. You know, many of the monitoring tools actually expose a kind of a query language that help you kind of get custom insights into your metrics. And this kind of, the query language may be actually SQL based, or, you know, it can be something very custom. So here I have mentioned, you know, two tools, but, you know, it can be other tools also. Anomaly detection, again, very, very important. I think many of us know the pain of setting static thresholds, and the fact that, you know, if your metrics are cyclic in nature in terms of the patterns they show, we want something to automatically detect those patterns and flag off these anomalies. Setting static thresholds is not the answer. But anomaly detection is not very, very easy to do. It's non-trivial. It's not like a single algorithm like Holt-Winters will apply for all the metrics. So then what do you do? You actually should have a monitoring framework or tool in place that at least exposes different algorithms, statistical algorithms like moving average, moving median, you know, standard deviation, Holt-Winters, and then you are able to kind of retrofit or fit those algorithms to your metrics and see which one works best. And based on that, your anomaly detection is then done automatically. But the question is, does your monitoring have that support in place? Or do you have to do it in a way where you actually are fetching all the metrics from your, you know, monitoring database and doing it all yourself in a separate kind of infrastructure, which also you can do, but the more important concept is anomaly detection is very, very important to get to. And finally, the power of event correlation in so much as, you know, the alerts, how they get correlated. We know the pain of, you know, getting thousands of alerts. I mean, it becomes very difficult to understand what the source of the problem is. So for example, if you have alerts coming from, 500 app servers, and there is a single database alert, most likely the source of all those 500 app server alerts is that single database alert. But when you actually get so many alerts, probably that one alert gets lost. So some of these tools like Moog Incident actually are able to aggregate alerts in such a way that you see all those 500 alerts from a given app server group as a single situation, and you see a database alert as a separate one. That immediately tells you something is wrong on the database side, and then you can go ahead and troubleshoot it. So with that, there are many other facets that I actually wanted to also discuss, which are around the speed of deployments. I think Dipanu spoke about, canary deployments and, blue-green deployments. How do you monitor the health of such deployments? You need your monitoring systems to be doing much more granular metric collection other than a one-minute resolution, which most of the monitoring tools do, because you need a very fast feedback loop for your deployment so that you can roll them back. There are other facets too, but I think I've been able to at least give you an overview of how you need to rethink about your monitoring, not from the tools perspective, but what you need in terms of the insights, in terms of the data, in terms of the information, and how perhaps then you can actually think about the tools that satisfy those needs. Thank you so much. Any questions?
What kind of decisions drive the analytics or decision making in your monitoring systems? Do you have any cases which are real time, which are based on trends, anything which you can share in that regard?
That's a very good question. I think more and more organizations are realizing the fact that monitoring system is just not a reactive system as it is perceived to be. There is a treasure trove of monitoring data out there. How can you use it to kind of get the deep insights that you need for something like a trend analysis, a capacity planning, or in the analytics thing, how do you expose something like a query language that I was talking about, which is able to give you the power to correlate metrics across different applications in any custom way that you want to. So for that, does the monitoring system have that ability itself, or do you need to do that, kind of build up the entire infrastructure for that? And does that answer your question? Yeah, so we actually use, in some of the tools, we actually use it for things like trend analysis and capacity planning. We extensively use the query language part of some of the tools that we use to kind of get more deeper insights into, the different parts of the system and correlate them. We actually do statistical functions on top of it. We also calculate complex expressions, but all of that is possible because the monitoring system exposes that kind of an interface.
In using monitoring for analysis, what was your tipping point when you used MySQL over there?
So the RRD tool at that point of time, it could do only one data write per second. So the IOPS, it was constrained by how much IOPS a given piece of hardware could do. At this point of time, I think there is support for batch writes and something like a RRD cache daemon. But at that point of time, we didn't have that functionality.
Right, but you said that even with MySQL, there was a tipping point because of sharding and...
Right.
So what was that tipping point really?
Right, so it all depends on how much you are willing to invest in, the MySQL sharding aspect of it. Typically when metrics reach in the order of millions of metrics per second, I'm not even talking per minute, then it becomes very difficult for... And it's not only the metrics themselves, there is the aspect of dimensions, basically the tags with which the metrics are associated. If those tags, the number of tags and their values increases, the cardinality of the metrics actually becomes very high. And that's when your star schema in a MySQL starts to melt down.
Can you please elaborate a bit more on the anomaly detection side? What anomaly detection, any open source software and is it free to use? And also based on your experience, how effective it is to detect different kinds of problems?
Yes, so as I said, you know, anomaly detection is still an upcoming kind of, look, anomaly detection is not old. It is used for fraud detection, intrusion detection. The only thing is it is now being used in monitoring area much more. And some of the tools, you know, like even graphite, if you see, it exposes things like moving average, moving median, and there is no single, in my experience, there is no single algorithm which works for everything. So for example, a Holt Winters actually works when you have a very rich set of historical data for the metric for it to be able to work properly. If you just want to do a rolling deviation kind of an you know, alerting or anomaly based on the last 10 minutes or 15 minutes of data, then you could pick up, you know, something like a moving median or a moving average. So there are libraries, you all know about the R library, but how do you integrate it with the monitoring and actually detect anomalies is actually the challenge. Many of the monitoring tools actually have that built in. Many of the organizations who want to do it separately.